Hello. I welcome you to the paper Mythological Traditions. We will start our discussion by defining myth. In this module, we will try to find the meaning and definition of myth from the commonplace perception. Following this, we will also see the origin of myth studies and how it followed and shaped the meaning of myth and mythology. Finally, the comparative anthropological view of myth, along with some eminent thinkers and their views of myth, will be studied. We will start our discussion with the question, what is myth? What do we, the common people, understand by myth? In the commonplace perception, myths generally include any narrative having fictitious elements. They are religious or heroic legends that someone cannot believe to be true. Thus, they are purely fictitious narratives involving supernatural persons, actions, or events, or embodying some popular ideas concerning natural or historical phenomena. Thus, it can be said that myths are symbolic tales of the distant past that concern cosmogony and cosmology, that is, the origin and nature of the universe. It may be connected to the belief systems or rituals and may serve to direct social action and values. Myths were considered by many scholars as survivals of previous times, perhaps decayed or reflective of primitive ancestors who took them literally. This does not mean our ancestors lived exactly as we do, or that we conceive of the world in identical ways, but myths serve us better as means of understanding our ancestors if we accept their capacity for complex intellectual and artistic expressions. However, this situation is considerably altered in literary criticism, either because the truth content of the myth is valued or because of its apparent spontaneity and collectivity. Equally attractive is the apparent universality and timelessness of myth. The fact that scholars discuss various possible definitions of myth demonstrates the vitality and importance of myth even today. Hence, it is important for us to go deep into this topic. The rise and growth of European imperialism and cultural anthropology happened in the imperial age. During this time, Europeans came into contact with great communities, customs, linguistic expressions, and religious practices that appeared strange to them. So, it was necessary to gain understanding of those novel savages. The fortune of myth thus rose gradually with this imperial age, when increasingly it was myth in its raw pre-literary state which captured the European imagination. Simultaneously, another set of understanding rose by reading classical myths such as Vedic or Greco-Roman. Vedic mythology refers to the mythological aspects of the historical Vedic religion and Vedic literature alluded to in the hymns of the Rig Veda. The central myth at the base of Vedic ritual surrounds Indra, who, inebriated with Soma, slays the dragon Ahi Vritra, freeing the rivers, the cows, and dawn. The word Vritra, Vritra, means obstacle. Thus, Vritrahan or Vritrangana is the smiter of resistance. Aspects of Indra as a deity are cognate to other Indo-European gods. They are either thunder gods such as Thor, Perun, and Zeus, or gods of intoxicating drinks such as Dionysus. It has directly contributed to the evolution and development of later Hinduism and Hindu mythology. Classical mythology of Greco-Roman mythology is the body of myths from the ancient Greeks and Romans as they are used or transformed by cultural reception, along with the philosophy and political thought. Mythology represents one of the major survivals of classical antiquity throughout later Western culture. Greek mythology is the body of myths and teachings that belong to the ancient Greeks concerning their gods and heroes. The nature of the world and the origins and significance of their own cult and ritual practices. It was a part of the religion in ancient Greece. Modern scholars refer to and study the myths in an attempt to throw light on the religious and political institutions of ancient Greece and its civilization, and to gain understanding of the nature of myth-making itself. Greek mythology is explicitly embodied in a large collection of narratives and implicitly in Greek representational arts, such as vase paintings and votive gifts. Greek myth attempts to explain the origins of the world and details the lives and adventures of a wide variety of gods, goddesses, heroes, heroines, and mythological creatures. These accounts initially were disseminated in an oral poetic tradition. Today, the Greek myths are known primarily from Greek literature. The oldest known Greek literary sources, Homer's epic poems, Iliad and Odyssey, focus on the Trojan War and its aftermath. Roman myths are traditional stories pertaining to ancient Rome's legendary origins, religious institutions, and moral models, with a focus on human actors and only occasional intervention from deities, but a pervasive sense of divinely ordered destiny. Roman myths have a dynamic relation to Roman historiography, as in the early books of Livy's Urbe Condita. The most famous Roman myth may be the birth of Romulus and Remus and the founding of the city, in which patricide can be taken as expressing the long history of political division in the Roman Republic. During the Hellenization of Roman literature and culture, the Romans identified their own gods with those of the Greeks, adopting the stories and told about them, and importing other myths for which they had no counterpart. For instance, while the Greek and Ares and the Italian gods Mars are both world deities, the role of each in a society and its religious practices differed often strikingly. But in literature and Roman art, the Romans reinterpreted stories about Ares under the name of Mars. The literary collection of Greco-Roman myths, with the greatest influence on later Western culture, was the Metamorphoses of the Augustan poet Ovid. Syncretized versions from the classical tradition of mythography, and by the time of the influential Renaissance mythographer Natalis, comes with few, if any, distinctions were made between Greek and Roman myths. The myths, as they appear in popular culture of the 20th and 21st centuries, often have only a tangential relation with the stories as told in ancient Greek and Latin literature. However, this knowledge has not deviated much from the anthropological definition of myth. Comparative mythology is the comparison of myths from different cultures in an attempt to identify shared themes and characteristics. comparative mythology has served a variety of academic purposes. For example, scholars have used the relationships between different myths to trace the development of religious and cultures, to propose common origins for myths from different cultures, and to support various theories. For comparative anthropologists, myths are answers to the awkward questions of the non-literate or pre-literate people, such as, who made the world? How will it end? Who was the first man? Who created him? Where does he go after death, etc.? And the answers to these questions are necessarily graphic and positive, and are integrated into the belief system of the group. Anthropologists were interested in the culture of the other, the objects of imperial inquiry. The interest was also instrumental in discovering the universal. They assumed that the modes of thought and action in narratives, including myths, are not peculiar to any of given location. They represent a general picture of savagery. This leads us to the concept of Ur-myth, a contribution of the comparative anthropologists. The basic concept of Ur-myth is that all myths are, in an important sense, the same story, with some variants only. They assumed that all cultures shared a certain pattern of potential growth and differed mainly in the stage of development that they have attained. This potential growth or evolutionary scheme is universal. This position is well explained by J.G. Fraser. He says, the study of savage life is very important because by comparison with the civilized man, the savage represents an arrested or retarded stage of social development. And an examination of his customs and beliefs accordingly supplies the same sort of evidence of the evolution of the human mind. Fraser says, when these savages look with awe at the natural phenomenon, they imagine stories to explain the unimaginable. These stories have been designated as myths. Now we will see what different thinkers have said about myth, starting with Bronislaw Malinowski. Bronislaw Malinowski invented the term charter myth. He was an ardent admirer of J.G. Fraser, declared in his book Myth in Primitive Psychology, that there is no important magic, no ceremony, no ritual without belief. And the belief is spun out into accounts of concrete precedent. For myth is not only looked upon as a commentary or additional information, but as a warrant, a charter, and often even a practical guide to the activities to which it is connected. Myth, according to him, is a charter of belief, a guide to practical life in social context. It justifies the social order, sanctifies the institutions, practices, customs, and moral codes. It provides a statement of the primeval, greater, and more relevant by which the present life, fates, and activities of mankind are determined. Thus, myths are means of propagation of collective conscience. Hence, to Malinowski, the function of myth, briefly, is to strengthen tradition and endow it with a greater value and prestige by tracing it back to a higher, better, or more supernatural reality of initial events. An extension of the anthropological assessment of the myth of the savages was the explanation of the ritual system, the instruments by which conviction is renewed and strengthened. The sociological significance of ritual rests on its acting as a binding force for the group with its psychological importance through the enactment of myth. There was a broad agreement, more or less, among early anthropologists who were more or less evolutionist comparatists on the significance of the myths. Rituals to them are implementations of belief. Next we come to Claude Lévi-Strauss. Claude Lévi-Strauss offered a different kind of analysis of myth. He did not ignore the universal criterion of analysis of myth, but he said that if we go about it in the right way, a comparison of these emasculated stories can still be made to exhibit the outstanding characteristics of a universal, primitive, non-rational logic. He also agreed with other anthropologists that myth contains a social message. It is not just a fictitious fairy tale. It may not be possible to identify from whom the message comes, but it is clean who is receiving it. He adds, the novices of the society who hear the myths for the first time are being indoctrinated by the bearers of tradition. A tradition which in theory has been handed down from long dead ancestors. Thus, to sum up, anthropologists viewed myths as socially relevant narratives and not as meaningless, fallacious exercise. Yes, it is true that myth essentially has an element of fantasy and imagination, yet it is an essential part of culture, a part of creed believed. It is designed to stabilize the society. The following conclusions can be drawn from the knowledge so far gained that, one, myth generates an identity, consciousness of a group. Two, it contains historical elements believed to be true by the members of the group. Three, myth prepares the base for the religious system. Four, it is not always meaningless, fallacious exercise. Five, it helps in stabilizing the society. The impressive contribution of the anthropologist in defining myths is their emphasis on the people's attempt at integrating the understanding of and reasoning for the cosmogony and the ground reality. Myths determine the identity of the ethnic group, narrating the common ancestry and formulating a worldview that in turn determines their religious, ethical and social systems and values. Thus, myths are in essence narratives with immense cognitive potential. We end our discussion of defining myth from a comparative anthropological view. We will look into other perspectives in our next modules. Thank you.